Welcome, my friends. In this video, we will be discussing joint probabilities and independent events. Let's consider two events. The first event is that it rains today. The second event is that on one flip of a fair coin, it lands heads face up. If you told me for certain you knew it was going to rain today, that wouldn't change my estimate of the chance of flipping heads on the coin. No matter if it rains or doesn't rain, there's still a 50% chance of the coin turning up heads. Two events are independent if the occurrence of one event does not change the probability that the second event occurs. If it rains today, that has no impact on the probabilities associated with my coin, so we know that events A and B are independent. What if we introduce a third event, which is that it's cloudy out today? Now consider the pair of events, it is cloudy out today, and it rains today. These two events share a relationship that was not present with the rain in the coin. If it's cloudy out, that changes the probability of it raining out. The occurrence of the first event, clouds in the sky, makes the second event, rain, more likely. We say that two events are dependent if the occurrence of one event does change the probability that the second event occurs. Just like there being clouds in the sky makes it more likely to see rain. The reason why we need to know if two events are independent or dependent is because it influences the way we calculate the joint probability that those two events happen together. We define two ways to calculate the joint probability of A and B. If the events A and B are independent, we can find the joint probability, the probability that both A and B happen together, by multiplying the probability of A by the probability of B. If the events A and B are dependent, or if we aren't sure whether or not A and B are independent, we can find the joint probability in one of two ways. Either we can take the probability of A and multiply by the probability of B given A, or we can take the probability of B times the probability of A given B. You should use whichever formula is more convenient in the problem that you're working with. These two formulas always work to find the joint probability, which is why I am calling them the general formulas for joint probabilities. If you aren't sure if your events are independent or dependent, you should use one of these formulas, and not the formula for independent events. Now, you may have noticed that we've introduced a new symbol here, the vertical line, which means given. This statement here is read, the probability of B given A, and is the probability that B occurs given that event A occurs. We call probabilities written like this conditional probabilities, because the probability of the first event listed is conditional on whether or not the second event occurs. For example, if A is the event that it's cloudy today, and B is the event it rains today, the probability of B given A is the probability that it rains today given that it's cloudy. We can rearrange the second general formula to solve for the conditional probability that A occurs given B has already happened by taking the probability that A and B happen together and dividing by the probability of B. To help you remember this formula, which is really important by the way, you need to remember that the top of the fraction is just the joint probability of the two events, and the denominator is just the probability of the event conditioned on, in this case, event B. Note that we must also assume that the probability of B is not equal to zero, so that we don't have a divide by zero error. Let's take a look at a few examples of how to use these formulas to answer probability questions. Suppose you are rolling two fair six-sided dice, and you are interested in the probability of rolling two sixes. Let A equal rolling a six on the first die, and let B equal rolling a six on the second die. These two events are independent. The outcome of the first die has no effect on the outcome of the second die, so we can find the probability of A and B by using this formula that we introduced on the previous slide. Since there are six sides of the die, and each outcome is equally likely, the probability of A is 1/6, and the probability of B is also 1/6. Plugging into the formula, we find that the probability of A and B is 1/6 times 1/6, which is equal to 1 out of 36. There is a 1 out of 36 chance of rolling two sixes. What about this example? Let's assume that you have six balls in a bag, two blue, two red, and two green. Two balls are selected randomly without replacing the first ball before selecting the second ball. What is the probability of drawing two red balls in a row? We let A equal drawing a red ball on the first draw, and B equal drawing a red ball on the second draw. Events A and B are dependent. Why? Well, because the outcome of the first draw changes the probability of the second draw. If a red ball is drawn first, there will only be one red ball remaining in the bag. If a non-red ball is drawn, then there will still be two red balls remaining in the bag. Therefore, the chance of drawing a red ball on the second draw depends on the color of the ball drawn first. Since the events are dependent, we must use the general joint probability formula for dependent events to find the probability of A and B. The probability of A and B, drawing a red and then a red again, is equal to the probability of A times the probability of B given A. The probability of A, drawing a red ball first, is 2 out of 6. There are 2 red balls out of the 6 equally likely chosen balls. The probability of B given A, the probability of drawing a red ball, given one red ball was already drawn, is 1 out of 5. There's only one red ball left out of the 5 remaining balls. Therefore, the probability of A and B is equal to 2 sixths times 1 fifth, which is equal to 2 out of 30, or 1 out of 15. There is a 1 out of 15 chance of drawing 2 red balls in a row. Sometimes it's difficult to tell whether or not two events are independent. Thankfully, we have a method of proving that two events are independent. Two events, A and B, are independent if it can be shown that one of the following three conditions are true. First, the probability of A given B is equal to the probability of A. Second, the probability of B given A is equal to the probability of B. And third, the probability of A and B is equal to the probability of A times the probability of B. These three conditions will either be all true or all false. So if you can prove one, you know that the other two statements are true, and that the two events are independent. If one is false, then you know the other two statements are also false, and the events are dependent. Glancing at the first two formulas, they actually flow logically from the definition of independence if you understand the notation. Take the first statement, for example. The probability of A given B is equal to the probability of A. The probability of A given B means the probability that event A occurs given that event B also occurs. If A and B are independent, the occurrence of B shouldn't make any difference to A's probability. That's exactly what this statement is saying. The probability of A given B occurs is the same as the probability of A. B occurring doesn't change the probability of A. The second statement is just the first one with B and A switched around, and the third one is the joint probability for independent events, which we looked at earlier. Let's look at an example. Suppose, based on historical data at a bakery, it's known that 20% of customers order muffins, 40% of customers order bagels, and 12% of customers order both muffins and bagels. Are the events ordering muffins and ordering bagels independent? Well, let's let A represent the customers ordering muffins, and B represent a customer ordering bagels. We are told that the probability of A ordering muffins is 20%, or 0.2, the probability of B ordering bagels is 0.4, and the probability of A and B is 0.12. We are asked if the two events are independent. To show two events are independent, we must prove one of these three statements that we looked at earlier. You should choose the statement that corresponds to the numbers given in the problem, which for us is statement number 3. Plugging in the numbers, we have 0.12 is equal to 0.4 times 0.2. Simplifying the right side of the equation, we have 0.12 is equal to 0.08, which is a false statement. Since we ran into a contradiction, that means that the events A and B are not independent. This means that the probability a customer orders muffins changes based on whether or not bagels were ordered, and vice versa. Here is a follow-up question given the same information. What is the probability a customer will order muffins given they ordered bagels, and the probability a customer will order bagels given they ordered muffins? This is equivalent to asking the conditional probability of A given B and the conditional probability of B given A. We said earlier that we have this formula for conditional probabilities, which is based on the general formula for joint probabilities. First, solving for the probability of A given B, we have the probability of A and B on top, which we know to be 0.12, divided by the probability of B, which we know to be 0.4, and that simplifies to 0.3. So the probability of a random customer ordering muffins, given that they ordered bagels, is 30%, slightly higher than the general probability of ordering muffins, which is 0.2. Now to find the probability of B given A, which is different from the probability of A given B, we must modify this formula. Anywhere you see B becomes an A, and anywhere you see an A becomes a B. So the probability of B given A is equal to the probability of B and A divided by the probability of A. Note that the probability of B and A in the numerator is the same as the probability of A and B. This is an important distinction. For and probabilities or joint probabilities, you can switch around the lettering. B and A is the same as A and B. But for conditional probabilities, you can't switch them around. A given B is not the same as B given A. So we have the probability of B and A, which is 0.12, the same as A and B in the numerator, and the probability of A, which is 0.2 in the denominator. This leaves us with 0.12 divided by 0.2, which is equal to 0.6. The chance of a random customer ordering bagels, given they ordered muffins, is 60%, which is higher than the general probability of ordering bagels, which is 40%. Alright, my friends, we have finished our discussion of joint probabilities and independent events. We will be exploring many more fun and exciting statistical topics that you won't want to miss, so make sure to check out our other videos.